Well, the Republicans in Congress are feeling their oats, and they've now called the king into account. Republicans are warning that if Barack Obama can get away with simply changing the law on immigration if he doesn't like it, what's to prevent future presidents from acting like dictators?
Now, congressional Republicans are trying to figure out how to respond to the president's move. David Brody has that story from Washington.
It may be December, but 4th of July fireworks were on display inside the House Judiciary Committee hearing room on Tuesday. Protesters interrupted the hearing several times as immigration reform supporters demanded action from Congress. But this hearing wasn't about possible policy moves on immigration. It was about whether President Obama abused his constitutional authority when he signed his executive order that allowed 5 million illegal aliens to stay in the country rather than be deported and to qualify for some government benefits as well. Congressional Republicans say the president went too far because only Congress can change federal immigration law.
President Obama has just announced one of the biggest constitutional power grabs ever by a president. He has declared unilaterally that, by his own estimation, almost 5 million unlawful immigrants will be free from the legal consequences of their lawless actions.
Republicans argue that the president even admits he can't do what he did. They tried to prove it with a video showing all the times that he admitted he couldn't change the law. And even after he passed his executive order, he said this.
I just took an action to change the law.
Jay Sekulow, chief counsel for the American Center for Law and Justice, believes the president's own words say it all.
He changed the law. Presidents cannot change the law. He can't do so constitutionally. He cannot do so under Supreme Court precedent. He can't change the law to comport with his preferred public policy.
Democrats on the committee push back, saying that the president is in his legal rights to use what's known as prosecutorial discretion, meaning that the president, like a prosecutor, can decide which crimes to prosecute and which laws to enforce. Republicans disagree. They say that stretches the idea of prosecutorial discretion far beyond its real meaning. They argue it doesn't apply to enforcing immigration laws that are passed by Congress. Democrats say it wouldn't have come to this if Republicans had passed immigration reform.
I defy any of my colleagues on this committee or anyone in Congress to tell me our immigration system is not broken. We know that it is. But I am disappointed that this Congress, like a number of them before it, has done nothing to fix the problem.
But despite Democrats trying to make the hearing about Republicans and immigration, witnesses on the panel pointed out the larger issue of how President Obama's executive action is going down a very treacherous road and that he could be setting a dangerous precedent.
The president's executive power does not give him the power to govern by decree. It does not give him the power to suspend the law. If he can actually do this and get away with it, I guess future presidents could say that they're going to suspend more parts of the Affordable Care Act. Maybe they'll suspend it all. You know, why we don't need a Congress to repeal it. We just need a president to say, I suspend it.
Sekulow says the president has made congressional action on immigration reform even more difficult to accomplish because the president has now made the argument about his actions rather than what to do about the immigration system.
My ultimate concern here is that the president's utilization of executive action has set back the debate on real immigration reform probably a couple of years because we're arguing procedure rather than substance.
Republicans are trying to figure out their next move now that the president is moving forward on his executive order. Speaker of the House John Boehner says the House will vote this week to undo his executive order. But at this point, it's just legislative window dressing because the president would, of course, veto any sort of bill like that. So where does it leave everyone? Well, it's a political chess game between Republicans and Democrats over a very volatile and emotional issue. David Brody, CBN News, Washington.
Thanks, David. I said before, I say it again, it's a trap. He was setting a trap for the Republicans. He knew they'd lost the election. The American people are turning against the Democrats because of their ways and, of course, the president, who is extremely unpopular these days with a vast number of people. He's losing the blue-collar white vote, The labor people are against him because of Keystone Pipeline and other actions like that. So he's catering to a very small minority of the population, and he's making an enormous amount of effort for that. But the biggest thing he's trying to do is to get the Republicans into an overreach. He wants them into an overreach, some extremists, so then he can point to them and say, the next election, you see those extremists, you see what they did. And the Republicans so far are not taking the bait. And I hope they will continue to exercise restraint regardless of how angry they are at what this man is doing. This is terrible what he's doing. But when it's all said and done, it'll take forever. You know, the man in charge of Homeland Security has been asked, are you going to actually talk to every one of these aliens? You're going to interview every one of them, all 5 million of them, you're going to tell me, oh, no, we can't do that. Well, how are you going to tell? You know, prosecutorial discretion, how are you going to tell who comes in, who doesn't, who's breaking the law, who isn't? Then he's talking about the possibility of giving these people Social Security and then giving them other benefits under the Health Care Act and other things like that. At each case, you're going to have 5 million people. You got the staff to do that. Well, no, we don't have the staff. It'll take a lot more money. Well, where are you going to get the money? Well, it's all a shell game. And ladies and gentlemen, just keep in mind, don't get your, self all in a sweat and a divot, as they say on it. Swivel it. Just take it easy. And recognize this thing's going to fall of its own weight. It has no possibility of being implemented because the staff doesn't exist to implement it. It can't be done. And the president knows that, but it's a trap. So if the Republicans won't jump into the trap, the president's lost. Well, in other news, a major shakeup now in Israel. Zippy Livni, who was at one time a candidate for prime minister, has opposed the government under Benjamin Netanyahu, and therefore, because they didn't have a coalition that was necessary for legislative action in the Knesset, the government collapsed. And the prime minister called early elections in the spring. John Jessup has that story from our CBN News Bureau in Washington. Here's John.
Pat, that collapse came as Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu fired two of his government ministers, leaders of separate parties. The early elections plunged Israel into a bitter campaign that seemed unlikely just days ago. Chris Mitchell brings us that story from Jerusalem.
In a televised address, Netanyahu accused two of his ministers of staging a government takeover. He told Israelis he couldn't run a government that was criticizing him and his policies.
I will not tolerate an opposition within the government anymore. I will not tolerate ministers attacking government policy from within the government, attacking its leader, motivated by political interests, and being irresponsible at a national level.
How to deal with growing Palestinian terrorism, building in Jerusalem, increasing concern over Iran's nuclear development, and a law to ensure Israel's Jewish character created divisions within the government. Israelis will vote in mid-March, 2 years ahead of schedule. TV opinion polls show the country veering right and bolstering Netanyahu's Likud party. But a lot can happen in the next 3 months. In Brussels, Secretary of State John Kerry declined to comment on internal Israeli politics.
We hope that whatever government is formed can negotiate and move towards resolving the differences between Israelis and Palestinians.
For now, Israel will plunge into a costly election campaign that may not bring the country any closer to solving the issues it's facing. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
President Obama is set to nominate a Pentagon executive as the new Secretary of Defense, replacing outgoing Secretary Chuck Hagel. Ashton Carter served under Hagel as the number two man at the Pentagon. Carter is respected by many leading Republicans as well as Democrats, but conservatives warn that Carter will have to deal with the White House's reported habit of trying to micromanage the Pentagon rather than let military top brass have the authority they need to run defense policy. Pat?
Well, that little cabal of advisors in the White House, they're children. They just are much of a youngsters. They don't have any knowledge of military policy. They don't have any knowledge of foreign affairs. I think they're motivated primarily by domestic politics. And so how does this play out in the polls next week? I mean, they're that kind of people. And they would be micromanaging the generals and the admirals in the Defense Department and the Defense Secretary, and it's just intolerable. And one after the other, they leave. And the one that was considered a very fine candidate, Michelle Flournoy, she said, no way, I'm not going to do it. And this man that's coming up now, he is regarded as a technocrat. He knows the details about how much it costs to build an aircraft carrier and when you have overruns and you don't. So in that respect, he'll be much better than the previous secretary who didn't have any clue about those things. But in terms of overall defense policy, I don't think he's up to the job. John?
Pat, Social Security could run out of money in just 10 years if the present trends continue, according to research from the Heritage Foundation. After major reforms back in 1983, the system was supposed to be financially solvent for 75 years until 2058. Now the official estimate from the government is that Social Security is projected to be insolvent much sooner in the year 2033. But the Heritage Foundation believes that if historical trends continue, Social Security could become insolvent in 2024, and it's expected to add nearly $1 trillion to the federal deficit in the next 10 years. Pat, a pretty bleak outlook there.
Look, if any CEO of any American corporation played the Ponzi game that Congress has been playing with your money in that so-called Social Security Trust Fund, you remember Al Gore talking about a lockbox? What a ridiculous thing. The deal is, all the money that you and I have paid into Social Security has immediately gone into the federal coffers to be spent on current spending. There has been no trust fund. And what they do in the place of the so-called trust fund, they get government IOUs. So they hold these pieces of paper issued by the government that says, you know, you've taken our money, now we owe you this much. So it's a trillion and another trillion and so forth. It goes down the drain. But what they're saying now is that whatever surplus or whatever name you want to give it that was coming out of the paychecks of American workers, there won't be enough workers to make up all those deficits that are coming down the pike. And they will be going after the so-called trust fund, which means they will take the government bonds and sell them on the open market and then use that money. But there's going to come some time that there's not going to be enough money to meet the demands. And at that point, a lot of young people, young adults, are going to be without any Social Security. If they continue the way they're going right now, they don't have to. They can change it. But as I said yesterday, it looks like we've just crossed the $18 trillion mark in our debt. That's an awfully lot of money that's got to be paid off. John?
Pat, the diet known as the Mediterranean diet could help keep you young because it's good for your cells. That's the finding in a study published in the British Medical Journal. The Mediterranean diet consists of vegetables, fruits, fish, whole grains, nuts, legumes, and olive oil. And it appears to help your chromosomes keep longer telomeres. Those are indicators of slower aging and fewer diseases. The study found that it took the whole diet, not just parts of it, to help keep people healthy and possibly living longer. Pat, the benefits of a healthy and balanced diet.
I'm sitting next to somebody who is so healthy, she just radiates health. Do you do all that stuff?
You know, that looks so delicious. I love fruits and vegetables.
Yeah, I do.
I do like some red meat, but if I had to choose between chicken, fish, and red meat, I would choose fish every time.
Amen. Well,
you know, so.
I have to take my hat off to PBS. They've got a guy on there that's pretty good about diet and so forth. And the emphasis has been very wisely on micronutrients found in nuts, all kinds of nuts, and berries, all kinds of berries, you know. And now he's going into mushrooms and beans, which I'm a great fan of beans. And I made some little.
You were talking about your lentil soup.
It's delicious. It is the best stuff, and you can lose weight. It just, you weight just, it's like it's on a.
Lentils are good for your brain, too.
Are they good for my brain?
Yeah.
I'm so happy.
And I also have a I think it's called a NutriBlast or something, and you can pulverize nuts and flaxseed, and you don't even taste it. You can make any kind of drink in that.
Well, I don't want to drink the nuts. I like to crunch them. Okay. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we will keep you healthy if you will listen to what we're telling you. But we've had the author of the South Beach Diet. He's a terrific guy, and that thing works. And why? You know what those telomeres are? You know, you've got those little things, and when the telomeres stay long, you're vital organs stay healthy. When the telomeres start getting shorter,
right.
They start dying. Your organs start dying. So what this is, it keeps the telomeres longer in the chromosomal balance. So you don't need to know all that. Just eat the nuts, Wendy.
And to help you get started on a healthier 2015, we'd like to send you this Protect Your Health DVD. It's full of expert advice on diet, exercise, and much more. We'll send it to you free of charge. Just call the number on your screen or log on to CBN.com.
The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention says the benefits from circumcision greatly outweigh the risks. In a draft released yesterday, it said the procedure can lower the risk of sexually transmitted diseases, penile cancer, and urinary tract infections for men. The CDC will take public comment for 45 days before finalizing the guidelines next year. The guidelines provide information but do not actually go so far as to tell parents to circumcise their sons, stating that they recognize that the practice is a personal decision that may involve religious or cultural preferences. Well, the Capitol Christmas tree was lit last night here in Washington. The 88-foot spruce beauty is from Chippewa National Forest in Minnesota. House Speaker John Boehner presided over the ceremony and reminded everyone that Christmas is a time to rediscover the glory of God's love. And he talked about the first Christmas when an angel announced the birth of a Savior, Christ the Lord. 10-year-old Aaron Urban, a brain cancer patient from Lithicum, Maryland, helped flip the switch to light the tree. The national Christmas tree at the White House Ellipse will be lit tomorrow. Well, you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com.